Eberron has now finally come to 5th edition D&D. I got a chance to sit down with Keith Baker to talk about his setting.
Well, the way I originally described Eberron, when you go back to 2002, in the one-page description was Lord of the Rings meets Raiders of the Lost Ark and the Maltese Falcon. So it is a world that is inspired by both sort of pulp adventure, you know, thrilling tales, but also sort of neo-noir intrigue, dark fantasy. And then added on top of that is this concept that arcane magic is essentially a science. And in Corvair, the main continent of Eberron, it's been worked into society. So a lot of people hear about Eberron and they think it's high magic. And what we're saying is it's really more wide magic. You don't have widespread teleportation or resurrection, but you do have the streets lit by continual flame. You have the lightning rail to get from city to city. You know, people are using wands in duels and things like that. So it's a world in which magic is a tool, not simply something in the hands of a few wizards. It's just always been a thing of mine that arcane magic behaves in a scientific manner. It's reliable. You can create a spell. You can teach a spell. You know, one wizard can teach a spell to another. And it's just that idea that if this behaves in a scientific way, why wouldn't it end up being a tool that we use? And sort of one of the core principles of Eberron was, if we had arcane magic in the Renaissance, what would the world look like today? You know, if that was the tool that we used instead of science. And so it was really just sort of those three things together. You know, what would it look like if you had sort of pulp adventure, and with that concept, if, you know, again, you're flying across the air in your airship and leaping off the airship to land on the lightning rail and rob it. You know, you're getting these sort of pulp adventure themes, but in a magical world. I mean, a couple of things about Eberron to me. First off, it is this sort of spectrum. It's designed as a world that has a place for a lot of different types of stories, and it's about sort of figuring out what is it you want to tell. So you have the absolute over-the-top pulp adventure, where racing through the jungles of Zendrick trying to get to the Orb of Dol Mazur before the Emerald Claw, and that's very much your Raiders of the Lost Ark, Uncharted, you know, sort of Tomb Raider, high action story. But then you also have the sort of gritty Streets of Sharn, more of a sort of almost Gangs of New York flavor. And so part of it is sort of deciding where are you going to fall on that spectrum. Do you want this sort of high action, swashbuckling story? Or, you know, again, the other aspect of Eberron is this darker story, you know, things where there's a lot more shades of gray and a lot sort of more difficult questions for players to deal with. And as I said, you can fall in that spectrum. There's a lot of different things that I do really enjoy, so it's hard to pick just one. I mean, one of the things I'll say, Eberron has a lot of elements that are things intentionally that we as a modern audience can connect to. So one of the things is you have the Last War, which is essentially the main continent was a united kingdom that fell into a terrible civil war and has gotten out of this decades-long conflict just very recently. And that war ended in a terrible event called the Mourning, that destroyed an entire nation. And you can think of it as a sort of Hiroshima level event, except the big thing is with the Mourning, no one knows how it happened or who did it. So you have this long, bitter war ended in a way where no one knows the cause and everyone is on edge. So we're in this Cold War because, again, we fear this possible destruction, but there's a tremendous amount of tension. There's still very much the case that no one won the war. Everyone still has their unresolved problems. And so it's a little bit, again, of going to that everyone's looking for an edge, everyone assumes that things are going to happen. And in making adventurers, you have this thing of this huge war ended 2 years ago. How did that affect you? Were you involved in it? If so, how? And so there's a lot of story hooks to play with that and to think about its sort of ongoing impact on the world. Another thing is we have the dragon-marked houses. Dragon marks are these sigils that give certain families sort of innate magical abilities. Those families have in turn used that to sort of corner areas of the magical economy. And these sort of play these roles essentially as sort of giant corporations. And so that again gives you some of these themes of, in the wake of the last war, the dragon-marked houses and with their economic power are actually sort of rising to be as powerful as the kings and queens of the surviving nations. And so it's again one of these things of it's an interesting balance for players to walk through of where do you stand on these issues, how do you interact with the houses. And as I say, between the houses, between the war, between the mourning, there's a couple of sort of major issues that do sort of relate to essentially things we deal with in our lives, but then cast through this fantasy lens.
Thank you, Keith Baker, for talking about the world of Eberron. I'm Todd Kenrick, your host. You can purchase The Wayfinder's Guide to Eberron on dndbeyond.com right now by clicking on the link in this video description. I'm Todd Kenrick. Thank you for watching.